Let's have a brief introduction of what Institute of Financial Accountant UK is, just a refresh. Institute of Financial Accountant UK was established in 1916, and this is an internationally recognized professional accountancy membership body. Institute of Financial Accountant UK is a group member of Institute of Public Accountants Australia and AAT Australia. This group has more than 36,000 members and students in more than 80 countries. So we have some global affiliations. We are the full member of International Federation of Accountants, member of CAPA, Confederation of Asian and Pacific Accountants, and IFA is a degree awarding body by OFCOL as well. Institute of Financial Accountant UK in Pakistan, we have more than 300 members in Pakistan, and we organize local CPD and networking events normally on quarterly basis that are physical in Lahore, Karachi, and Islamabad. But now we have planned to organize two online CPD sessions in a month, specifically for Pakistan. We are working with local universities and professional bodies, and we have a local branch presence in Lahore, Karachi, and Islamabad. We have different objectives at Institute of Financial Accountant UK. As I said, that this is a largest SME focus group all over the world. So our objectives are to develop SME sector in Pakistan. So we are also providing technical knowledge and expertise to scale the small enterprises, and eventually we will be adding value to the human capital and SMEs in Pakistan. There are some membership benefits as well. As we are the full member of IFAC, so enhanced recognition due to the full membership of IFAC, international reputation. The membership is portable, supporting career development opportunities globally, because we have more than 36,000 members in more than 80 countries, so this is a portable. There are two memberships of Institute of Financial Accountant UK and IP Australia. And we also hold local CPDs, and there is access to top-up degree programs at different universities, just like University of Northampton at UK and University of Deakin at Australia. So this is a brief introduction about PIFA. As everyone knows, that Pakistan Institute of Public Finance Accountants, company set up under Section 42 of the Companies Act. This is jointly constituted by ICAP, ICMAP, and Auditor General of Pakistan. So admissions are also open in BIFA, and BIFA is also an associate member of International Federation of Accountants, and now going to become a full member probably. Then there are other gateway examinations for CA intermediate, CAF level students, and ICM intermediates. We have Lexicon, that is the IFA endorsed program provider. And at Lexicon, we are providing different certifications and trainings, that is certified financial modeler, certified financial leader, and advanced diploma in accounting and finance. We have very distinguished speaker for our today's session, Mr. Mia Muhammad Ramzan. He is fellow member of Institute of Chartered, Institute of Cost and Management Accountants of Pakistan, fellow member of Institute of Public Finance Accountants of Pakistan, and fellow member of International Accountants UK. The list is pretty long, so I have written some points over here. Mr. Mia is a partner at Tarak Mia Ramzan Arshad and Company, a member firm of Cost and Management Accountants. He is chief executive at TMR Consulting. This is a firm specifically for ERPs and financial systems. They are gold value-added resellers of Microsoft Dynamics. He has more than 24 hours of professional experience of working in private and public sector organizations. He had conducted many trainings, including SAMIDA, Lahore Chamber of Commerce and Industries, Islamabad Chamber of Commerce and Industries, and Institute of Cost and Management Accountants of Pakistan and PIFA. So thank you very much, sir, for your valuable time. कि आपने आज ये स्पेसिफिकली सर जो है वो इंटरनेशनल टूर के ऊपर है, उनसे रिक्वेस्ट की थी कि आप हमें टाइम दें. सो थैंक यू वेरी मच सर. सो वी हैव अवर स्पेशल गेस्ट मिस्टर जहद फरूक, हु इज फेलो मेंबर ऑफ इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ चार्टर्ड अकाउंटेंट्स पाकिस्तान and fellow member of Institute of Cost and Management Accountants of Pakistan and fellow member of Institute of Financial Accountants UK. He is Islamabad branch chairman for Institute of Financial Accountant UK. So thank you very much, sir, for your valuable time as well. So this was from my side. So I would like to request Sir Mia Muhammad Ramzan to please share your presentation. And I'm pretty sure that the participants will really enjoy this presentation. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Abdul Shakur and Zahid Farooq Saab. I can see Aga Saab as well, and there are many other guests. So before starting my presentation, I would like to have a half minute introduction of each one who is, if the admin can allow everybody, so that I can know the participants, so that my presentation would focus on the, according to the participants who are there, so that I can skip or add some more points according to the requirements of the audience. So Mr. Admin, can you please allow each participant to give their brief introduction, that what is their name? I mean, are they member of professional accounting body and where they work? Only half. हेलो हेलो सॉरी
परमिशन मैंने दे दी है वो अपने माइक म्यूट कर सकते हैं
ओके
थैंक यू
सो ओनली फॉर हाफ अ मिनट आई वुड रिक्वेस्ट एवरीबॉडी टू प्लीज ब्रीफली इंट्रोड्यूस जस्ट नेम प्रोफेशनल क्वालिफिकेशन और मेंबरशिप ऑफ एनी आई मीन प्रोफेशनल बॉडी एंड वेयर दे वर्क ओनली दिस इज नीडेड सो दैट आई कैन फोकस माय in presentation and specific to the concern to the audience.
Thank you, sir.
Hello.
This is Abbasin Tahir. I am an ACCA member and I work in Keep Trucking as a senior corporate accountant. I look after accounts payables and fixed assets. So mostly this is the reason why I have joined your session, because there will be an overview about withholding taxes and sales taxes, which I look after, you know, when I'm processing the payments of vendors or when we are doing procurement. So that's why I joined this session. I am looking forward to.
So that's great. That's great. Yes. Next, please.
Thank you, Mia Muhammad Ramzan. This is Asif Peace. I'm the fellow member of ICMAP. And I can see smile on Mia Ramzan. We know each other since 1992. I really joined this session just because of you, and I can see you live. I'll be seeing you until unless I get so much busy. So okay. Thank you for the opportunity.
So thank you, dear. Thank you so much. Yes. Yes, please. Anybody else?
My name is Adil Bhatt. I'm based in Karachi from CAMS College. I'm a director over there and a CEO, and I am a fellow member of the Institute of Financial Accountants of UK and of IPA Australia.
Yeah. So you are in a university? And
Yes, it's a college, professional accountancy college, and we've been training chartered accountants and ACCAs for the last 26 years.
That's great. That's great. Thank you. Thank you, Jay.
Yes. My name is Asadullah Khan. I'm Chief Internal Auditor with the Bank of Punjab. I'm a IFA member and MIPA, and also I'm ACAM. It is the Association of Accountants of Malaysia.
Oh, that's great. Yes, next.
Yes, I'm Habjida, and working in tax department in Saudi Arabia and Toys R Us. And I've completed my MBA and a part of IFA.
Okay. So what is your interest in Pakistan withholding taxes?
We are working for international tax. I'm here responsible for all over the world. So we have also in Saudi Arabia, for the payment side, we have withholding tax. Normally people, they have then understanding that there are no taxes in Saudi Arabia.
Okay. That's good. Okay, I will start with the complete introduction of taxation system in Pakistan. That would help you to understand what is there. Okay, thank you. Yes, next please.
Sir, maqbool hai hum sir.
Maqbool. Ji ji, maqbool hai man.
Sir, I am a commerce graduate from Delhi College of Commerce.
Assalamu alaikum ji. My name is Faisal Naseem ji. I am a CPA qualified. I'm a member of IPA and all this UK and Australia. And I'm also doing my CIMA. I have just one paper left of the case study. I've worked in Mobil in USA. I've worked in a trading organization in Dubai for 8 years. I've recently moved to Pakistan a couple of years ago, and I'm working in Sukhchain Garden Private Limited. It's a real estate company in Lahore, and I'm working as a GM finance there.
Okay, that's great. Thank you. Next, please.
My name is Freddy Sidwa. I'm a member of IFAC and IPA, and have the a professional and a finance profession. And currently, I'm the CFO and treasurer of BMH Association.
CFO in?
Sorry?
In which country?
I'm in Pakistan, Karachi, okay. Pakistan.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Freddy.
You're welcome.
Hello, Assalamu alaikum. Mohammed Risalat Hussain here. I work in HPL Finance, Karachi office. I'm looking after the regulatory section here. I'm a member of AFA, NIPA, and I'm also a charter accountant affiliate. So I'm here to know the withholding tax rules and their upgrade as per the new budget. Okay. And looking forward to hearing from you, Mr. Rizwan.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for joining. Yes. So all done. All have done their introduction, please. Dear Edmund.
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Muhammad Ali. I am ACMA finalist and done my MSc in Accountant Finance. And currently I am working as CFO in a software house based in Lahore. And I'm keen to learn the tax saving tips for salaried class. Unfortunately, this class is hit by 20-40% tax amount since 2019. So I'm looking forward.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Yes.
Assalamu alaikum. I am Mohammed Umair, ICMAP finalist, currently working in Jaffer Group.
In which group?
Jaffer Group of Companies.
Jaffer Group of Companies. Okay. Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Assalamu alaikum, ji. Asif Kamal Barki here, sir. I am currently working as Chief Internal Auditor at Khyber Pakhtunkhwa Oil and Gas Company. Which is established in Peshawar, sir. Looking forward for a very nice and learned session with you people.
Okay, that's great. Thank you so much. So all done? Are there is anybody left?
No, sir.
Okay, thank you very much. I mean, all are very much qualified members who are participants of this meeting, and many of you must be more learned than me. Basically, we learn from each other. Definitely, I mean, you are all professional accountants, and you all have, basic. Even some of you may have in-depth knowledge of the taxation. So my presentation will focus on the withholding taxes according to the income tax and sales tax laws, and that will also include some amendments which has been recently made through Finance Act 2020. So let's start from the presentation. I will start from the appetizer that is just to get you involved that what the taxation is, and then we will slowly move forward towards the withholding taxes actual provisions. So let me share my presentation with you. So can everybody see the presentation now? Is it visible to everybody?
Okay, that's great.
I think all of the participants know the Urdu language as well. I think there is nobody who does not know the Urdu. Anyhow, I can use both the languages simultaneously. There would be no issue for me as well. And sometimes if somebody would require, I can explain it in the national language as well. So my dear fellows, accountants, professional accountants, qualified accountants, thank you very much for attending today's session. And I'm also very thankful to PIFA and other institute. They have jointly organized this session. This is very important. And I would just like to start from this picture, which I usually start. This is just to get your attention that what it is, what this picture shows. So this picture is that when people, because this is a non-interactive session, because webinars are not like that, which we used to have the seminars in some training hall. So this picture is then when people used to live in caves, and there was no society and no civilization. And then, civilization started and people started living together. And in this way, the society came into being. And when they started living together, there were some common things which all the inhabitants of that society enjoyed. And for that common things, they used to collect or contribute from the inhabitants of that society. And then they started living together. But the basic, overall security of that society and some basic needs like roads or sewerage system that was started, and that was met through the contribution of those inhabitants who were living there. And then the modern society came into being. And then, there are countries and governments, they run their affairs. So there are different services, shared services, which government shares to the inhabitants of that country. So those needs are met through the contribution, which is now in the form of taxes. So that is how the taxes emerged. So then there would be world of, more advanced world in future, which has just being started. And then you will see that more civilization, although now the people are more civilized, and then civilization will emerge into planets and everything. So I used to define the taxes. The tax is the price of for living in a civilized society. Because when there was no civilization, the people used to earn their living by themselves, and there was no shelter, there were no common facilities. So there was no need to have the pool of money. And when people used to live in civilized society, so there is need of the common facilities. And for common facilities, there is a cost. And for that cost, the governments or the administration of that country started collecting taxes so that they can spend on their society. So you might have seen that the more civilized society where there are different more facilities, they are collecting more taxes from their inhabitants. So there are different canon of taxation as well. You all have read in the theory as well. So we will just get start from here. The tax is the price for living in a subsidized society. So in every country, there is a budget every year, and we have budget for 2020, which has recently been approved in announced in May 2020. So you all know this is just pictorial. I'm just wanted to show that mean what the budget of every country is. There are expenditure on one side. You all are professional accountants, and there are incomes and sources on the other side. And the income and sources, one of the bigger sources of the income is for the governments is the tax collection. As you can see here, that in 2020, out of 8.9 million, 5.4 million is the tax revenue. This is the FBR taxes and other taxes it also includes. That is the federal budget. And if we see that how much are the FBR taxes, which includes the federal taxes, the basically three laws are there to collect these taxes. These are three types of taxes which we'll discuss later. That is 4.9 trillion target for the next year. So this is another overview of the current budget, that what type of taxes the government is going to collect, and that is income tax, direct taxes and indirect taxes. And you can see the figures that direct taxes and indirect taxes, the percentage, 38% is the percentage of direct taxes, and around 54% is the indirect taxes. So this is how the taxes contribute towards the economy, so to feed the government expenditure. So now we come to the taxation system in Pakistan, especially for our friend from KSA, who just intended joined the session to know the taxation system in Pakistan. So taxation, what is how the taxation is being in being done in Pakistan, like every country. So there are two types of basically taxes. The one is direct taxes, and another is indirect taxes. Direct taxes, the income tax, and we can define it that the direct taxes are those where the incidence is borne by the person from whom the tax is collected. So you all know the definition because all are professional accountants, and there are indirect taxes. In the case of indirect taxes, the person from whom the tax is collected only acts only as an agent or intermediary. The VAT in KSA and UAE and Gulf countries is the example, and in Pakistan is the sales tax. So this is a type of indirect tax which is basically being collected from the registered person who collect from the end consumers. So this is indirect tax, and sales tax, federal excise and customs is called the indirect tax in Pakistan. So what is the mechanism, just for the purpose of understanding the income tax, how the income tax mechanism work? Income tax basically is a tax based on the quantum of income earned by a taxpayer during an income year. The tax rates and method of calculating definitely varies with the status of the taxpayer and the type of businesses sometimes as well. The status and types of taxpayers are the individuals, individuals include salaried individuals and other individuals, then business entities, and there are three basic types, legal type of entities, that is sole proprietorships and association of persons to whom we call the partnerships, and then the companies, the corporate companies who are registered with the Securities and Exchange Commission of Pakistan. And there are other type of taxpayers as well. Other organizations obliged to work as withholding tax agents. They also come under the definition of the taxpayers. And what is the collection mechanism of the income tax? So there are three collection mechanisms exist in Pakistan. One is annual collection through annual tax returns. You might have heard that every the financial year consists financial year of 12 months consists of 12 months, 1 year, And after close of every financial year, there is annual return forms which the taxpayers, the above stated taxpayers, has to fulfill those forms and submit to the tax authorities. And whatever tax they're due, they pay their taxes through the annual income tax returns. So then there is another mechanism on certain entities, business entities. There is advance tax collected under Section 147 of the Income Tax Ordinance 2001. That is on the basis of last year's income or turnover, and the business entities pay their tax quarterly, so that the government can have revenue in advance, and also there is no burden at the year end when the tax return is due. And then there is another regime through which the tax is being collected, which has become more popular and more easy for the government. That is the withholding tax. So, which is the topic of our today's session as well. Withholding tax regime, this is basically a transaction-based tax collection. When every transaction is occurred, at that time there is certain obligation of the withholding tax agents, and then they deduct some tax and then pay in the government treasury. So there are three types of collection mechanism, and withholding tax regime has become more easy and more popular for the government. And then if I say that in income tax, I will show the figures on the next slide, that more than 70% of the income tax is being collected through the withholding tax regime. Then we come to the tax mechanism for the indirect taxes, that is sales tax and federal excise. Sales tax and federal excise is collected on sale of goods and on certain taxable services. And this is also a transaction-based consumer tax. And types of taxpayers in this case are only the business entities whose business is supply of taxable goods or provision of taxable services. And the collection mechanism for sales tax and federal excise is that from business entities doing taxable activity, withholding tax regime is also there, and then mostly collected on monthly basis. So here the tax period is only for 1 month, and in the income tax, the tax period is of the 12 months, mean of 1 year. So this is another slide that I was just asking, that how much tax is being collected through withholding tax, withholding regime. So this is a yearly book of FBR, which is published and which is available on the FBR site. This is the latest yearly book which was available. So collection, how the collection of the income tax and the other taxes is made. So this is a collection of the income tax and sales tax also. So in collection on demand, that is the areas, tax amnesty, and all that is only 6.7%. And if we see this is only the 6.7% of the within from the income tax. And if we see the overall percentage, that is 2.71 of the tax collection through collection on demand. Collection on demand means this also include the adjudication and cases and everything for which the whole tax machinery basically works. And then the voluntary payments, which I say that this is also one of the mechanism, that is with tax returns and advance tax under Section 147, this is to constitute 24.56%. And overall, if we see the overall percentage, it is 9.82%. So then 69% is through withholding taxes, which we are going to discuss. That is mean on contract payments, imports, salary payments, dividends, telephone, electricity. Each type of percentage is given here. This is just for your knowledge, that how much tax is being collected through withholding tax regime. So this was just an overall overview of the taxation system, and now we come to the withholding taxes and withholding taxes, few concepts under the income tax law. First, we will discuss the withholding taxes under the income tax law and then under the sales tax law as well. So withholding taxes under the income tax law, first we need to understand few concepts so that we can better apply our knowledge while acting as withholding tax agent, or we can understand that what withholding taxes are. So then income tax, as you all know, is a tax that is based on the quantum of income. Whosoever is raising hand, I think we can have a 15 to 20 minute session at the end of the end. So, and there are certain things which may be clear to you at the end of the presentation. So will it be okay for all? So income tax overview is that income tax is a tax based on the quantum of income, as you all know, and rates and methods of calculating income tax varies with the status of the taxpayer, and how the tax on the taxable income is done, that is, the income tax is payable each year, applicable on every person who has taxable income, and on the income of the taxpayer, there are certain deductions which are allowed and tax credits, and then we compute the net income. So this is about the income tax, and then the taxpayer definition under section 2. Any person who drives an income chargeable to tax under this ordinance and includes any withholding, any person who drives chargeable tax under this ordinance and is required to act as withholding agent, that is also come under the definition of the taxpayer under the income tax ordinance. So then types of the taxpayers, as I have already explained, that individuals, salaried individual, business proprietors, and other individuals, business entities, that includes association of persons, then companies, and then withholding tax agents, business entities and non-business entities, including non-profit organizations, and federal government, provincial government, and local governments, that is also the types of the taxpayers under the income tax ordinance. Then there is we need to understand the definition of resident and non-resident, because for resident there are different provisions for the withholding, and for non-resident there are different. So for resident and non-resident, there is section 82, which defines that resident, who is the resident individual. If resident individual is prior to Finance Act 2019, the definition was only if the person is present in aggregate more than 183 days in a year, that person becomes a resident. But in 2019, the definition was further amended that in any, this is the one condition, and another condition is that if the person, these are independent conditions basically. One condition is if a person is present in Pakistan for more than 183 days, he will be considered as a resident person. And if a person is present in Pakistan for 125 days or more in the tax year and 365 days or more in aggregate in the preceding 4 years, that person will also become the resident person for the tax purpose. And then government employee remain the resident person irrespective of his stay. Wherever he is posted, he will remain the resident person. Then resident company, section 83 defines, this is for the business entities incorporated or formed by under any law in force in Pakistan, that will become the resident company. And resident AOP, if the control and management, AOP mean partnership, if the control and management of the affairs of the company or of the association, AOP is situated wholly or partly in Pakistan, in any time of the year, it will be considered as resident. So this is the scope of overall taxes in Pakistan. These are the heads of income. You all might have read in your theory in taxation papers that this is the this is the scope of income tax, and these are the heads of income which are taxable under the income tax law. So income from business, salary, property, capital gains, and income from other sources. So heads of income, again, you can, this is just for the knowledge, to increase your further knowledge. I have just given in the slides that mean you can study further. Although this is not relevant to the withholding taxes, but to understand the withholding taxes, we need to have the overall knowledge of the income tax law so that we can better understand the withholding tax provisions. So these are relevant sections, and it also defines that what it includes. So now we come to withholding tax. What is withholding tax? Withholding is an act of deduction or collection of tax at source. Although it is part of direct taxes, but the way it is being collected, as I said, that it is also being collected through the agents who are making the payment to the final payee. They deduct the tax and deposit in the government treasury. And in this way, the way it is being collected, we may call it indirect tax, but in fact, it is a direct part of the direct tax. So why withholding tax? I mean, what was the need of for this type of tax? I mean, to impose the tax on the transaction-based tax. Basically, the income tax by definition is that whatever one earns during an income year, then he has to compute the profit or net income and then to pay the tax. But why the withholding tax has become so popular, and you have seen in the yearbook of 2017-18 that 69 or 70% of the tax is being collected through withholding regime. So this is one of the reason is to manage the government cash flows. Government cannot wait, especially the government like ours, they cannot wait, because we have to, we are running the affairs of the country mostly on the loans, and or there is always budget deficit and shortfall. And if we collect the taxes late, I mean after the year ends and then there is a filing time, then the government may face the further cash flow problem and may have to borrow further loans, and then there is a cost as well. So this is one of the reasons that to manage the government cash flows. Another is to facilitate the taxation authority for collection of tax. So taxation authorities are being facilitated through this regime. And now there is a separate withholding tax commissioner and wing in the FPR tax offices, and their task is only to monitor, and tax is being collected by the business entities themselves. They have obliged them, they have make their obligation to collect the tax on the behalf of the government and deposit in the government treasury. So in this way, there is a facilitation for the tax authority. They only just monitor, and then the tax is being collected by the business entities themselves while making the transactions. And then in this way, the government taxation authorities are being facilitated. And then there is a transaction-based monitoring as well. In wherever the transaction occur, the withholding tax agent has to pay the tax, collect the tax from the payee, and then deposit in the government treasury. So that is also mean one of the the mechanism of monitoring becomes more strong in this way. There is another concept of active taxpayer list, because in withholding taxes, since 2013, there has been a regime that the withholding cost for the active taxpayers and non-active taxpayers, there is a difference in the withholding tax cost. Previously, the concept of filer, non-filer was filer and non-filer was introduced in 2013, and it worked till 2019. And the concept is the same. Active taxpayer list is maintained for those taxpayers who are on the tax roll and who have filed their tax returns in time with the taxation authorities, and then there is a lesser cost because the number of taxpayers in terms of documented taxpayers who declare their income with the taxation authorities was too low. And through this regime of putting extra burden and extra cost on the non-filers or non-active taxpayers, now the number has increased. Now I think near 2.7 million are the filer or the active are the persons who are on the active taxpayers list, which in 2013 was less than 0.8 million. So active taxpayer list means the person is the list instituted by the board under section 181A and includes such list issues by the Azad Jammu and Kashmir Central Board of Revenue or Gilgit-Baltistan Council Board of Revenue. So this list is being updated and maintained by FBR on the basis of the tax return files who file their tax return. In time, their list is updated in the ATL, in active taxpayer list, and it starts from 1st day of March every year. And for the tax year 2019, suppose, the list was updated on 1st day of March 2020. So now on the 1st day of March 2020, the list was updated on the basis who filed their return for the tax year 2019. And prior to that, after that, this will continue till 28th February. And whosoever files the late returns late, they have to pay surcharge to become the filer under section 182A. Otherwise, the filer does not mean that he will become the, his name will appear in the active taxpayer list unless he pays the extra amount of surcharge, which in case of individual is only 1,000, in case of business entity is 20,000. So then there is special provision last year in 2019 was introduced. Previously in the rate schedule, the rate for filer and non-filer were prescribed in each tax rate schedule. But in 2019, they abolished all the rates for filer and non-filer, and one section 100D was introduced, and then a 10th schedule was also inserted in the income tax ordinance, and that provisions include the special provisions were provided in with respect to income tax computation of income and tax payables determined according to the rules provided in the 10th schedule. So in the 10th schedule, the rate of deduction or collection of tax was to increase for the non-active taxpayers by 100%. I mean, whosoever is not appearing on the ATL, their tax rate, withholding tax rate would be double. And there are certain exceptions as well. This is updated because Truth Finance Act 2020, certain provisions were deleted with consequent to the deletion of certain withholding provisions as well. So these are the sections where double tax or the 100% increase in withholding tax would not apply. So these are in case of salary, there is no double taxation, double withholding in case of non-filers. And then exports, rent, cash withdrawal from bank, NCCPL, and electricity consumption. These are the sections through which if withholding applies, there would be no double taxation. So there is another concept of exemptions and limitation of exemptions. Exemptions and limitation of exemptions provides that section 54 of the income tax ordinance defines that no provision in any other law providing for any exemption, any reduction, or any reduction of anything will not apply if it is not specifically provided in this income tax ordinance. It means that if someone something has been provided in any other law, like in the Mines Act or some other law, that mean the income of certain person or withholding of certain person is exempt from tax. But if it is not provided in the income tax ordinance, that would not be exempt. And then limitation of exemption also applies in case there is a specific exemption for one person, and it will not pass on to the other person just because of the income is being spent by that person who is exempt. The other person will not be exempt from that tax. This is in case of NGO, non-profit organization. If the income of the non-profit organization is exempt, it does not mean the person who is working with that organization, like a salaried person or any contractor, that his income will also be exempt until unless he gets the specific exemption in that case. So mean there is where the any income is exempt from the tax under this ordinance, an exemption shall in the absence of a specific provision to the contrary contained in us will not be extended to the other person who is getting or receiving some payment from that person who is exempt from tax. I hope this this is now clear to all of you the basic concepts. So withholding agent, who is withholding agent? The withholding agent is the person who is obliged to deduct or collect tax at source under different provisions of the income tax ordinance, and they are called the withholding tax agent. They have certain obligations because they have to, while making any payment or while making any transaction, they have to have collect or deduct the tax and then deposit in the government treasury. So types of withholding agent mean tax paying organizations. Those are the business entities. They are the withholding tax agents. And then there are certain non-tax paying organizations who are also withholding tax agent. That includes the government organizations, departments, NGOs, non-profit organizations. So these are the withholding tax agents. So I think we have understood the concepts and overall taxation system and everything. Now we come to the specific provisions of the withholding taxes. The first is the salary. On salary, almost 100% tax is being collected through withholding tax regime, because there is duty of every person who is paying salary that he has to hold the tax and withhold the tax from the employee if the salary is exceed the taxable limit, and then he has to deposit in the government treasury. So I have just prepare this with respect to that who is withholding tax agent, because for different provisions of the income tax ordinance, withholding provisions, all persons are not withholding tax agent. Those are specifically defined in the specific provision. Like in case of salary, who is the withholding tax agent or who is liable to collect the tax is that collect the tax mean withholding. Who is the withholding tax agent in case of salary? Here, the person responsible for paying salary to any employee. Irrespective of the status of that person, whether it is a sole proprietorship, whether it is a government entity, whether it is NGO, whether it is a company, every person who is paying the salary, who has employed someone and who is paying the salary and salary exceeds the taxable limit, then he has to deduct the tax. He has to act as withholding tax agent. And from whom? Mean definitely the employees who work for that organization. And slab rate is 0 to 35%. Sorry, 25% was the I missed it. And in the rate schedule, it is there. And nature, this is adjustable for the person from whom the tax is collected. Again, I deleted certain slides from here due to time limitation. That means the tax which is being collected or deducted, that has again that is being treated by the person from whom the tax collected by the tax authorities in three ways, while determining their own tax liability. For salaried individual, whatever tax is being collected by the employer, that is adjustable. At the year end, he will compute his tax liability according to the income, and then whatever tax has been paid, that will be adjusted. And if there is some tax extra deduction, that will be refundable to him. And if there is less deduction, the balance will be payable by the salaried individual. So every employer is required to deduct tax from the salary paid to employee at the time of payment at the rates which are specified in the first schedule. And these are the rates. You all have the rate tables updated. This year there is no change. Last year there was change, but this year the rates are remained the same. There was no change. So this is the basic exemption. The BTL amount is 600,000. The below taxable limit is 600,000, and above that, the different slab rates exist from 600,000 to 1.2 million, 5% of the amount exceeding 6 million. So these are the maximum slab rate is 35%, which is in case of the salary income exceeding 75 million rupees per annum. So these are the rates for the per annum. And we all know that tax is calculated on the basis of annual income. And on annual income, the tax is computed, and then it is divided on the months, months of the year, and then on monthly basis, it is being collected and deposited in the government treasury, because the tax salary is being paid on monthly basis. And if there is any change, then you have to recompute the tax in between. So there was one of our friend who works in the colleges and universities. So there are certain reductions available, and that is for the full-time teachers and researchers who work in the government organizations, government educational institution or universities recognized by the Higher Education Commission, including government training institutes and research institutions. So their tax amount will be reduced by 25% of the tax payable in his income from salary. So first they will compute the tax amount on the total salary, and whatever tax is computed, that is reduced by 25%. Mean their tax liability is 75% of the tax liability. So this is one relaxation, and then adjustments permitted by the employer. This is most frequently asked question by the participants. In section 149, since 2007 or 8, there is a provision was introduced in section 149, because there were certain deductions and adjustable taxes whose adjustment was not allowed previously, and then the salaried person had to apply to the tax authorities for refunds. So this provision was introduced in 2007 under section 149, that the employer is allowed to take into account the following things for adjustment of the tax, so that the net liability is adjusted according to, and there is no suffering for the employee. And that is, the employer is allowed to adjust the adjustable taxes withheld from the employee under any other provision of the income tax ordinance. Like if an employee purchase any property, and his tax is, he has to pay tax under section 236K, and that tax is adjustable, and he can submit the form IT3 to the employer along with the evidence, and then the employer can reduce his withholding tax and adjust that while deducting the tax from his salary. and like telephone and other telephone tax on withholding tax on telephone, that is also adjustable. But one thing to remember is that the tax for the same year is adjustable, not for the previous year. If you have any evidence for the previous year, for the tax year 2000, suppose now the tax. Like now for the tax year 2020, that ends on 30th June 2020, and any evidence for the relating to tax year 2020 will not be adjustable in this tax year 2021, because after July tax year 2021 has started, so that will not be adjustable in the next year. But that tax is adjustable only within that tax year. If you have any extra evidence, then while filing the return, you have to adjust that tax in your tax return, and there you can claim the refund from the taxation authorities. So any excess deduction or deficiency from the previous deduction during the month, they can also be adjusted. And then tax credits for salaried individual, which are available under Section 61, 62, like investments in public shares, insurance premium, and everything, those are also adjustable, because those reduce the tax liability of the tax person. I have just mentioned few of the sections, like cash tax collected through bank on the banking transactions. Now that there is no, I mean, for the filers, there is no withholding basically. Tax collected on registration of new car or Jeep, that is also mean handsome amount. If you buy a new car, that is handsome amount, you can adjust, get it adjusted from the employer. And in respect of motor vehicle token tax, you can get it adjusted. Telephone, you pay the tax on the telephone, you pay the tax on domestic air ticket, that is also adjustable. And deduction under section 236C, in transfer of immovable property, you have to pay certain tax under section 236C, and 236D has been deleted now, and 236I, that is also deleted, but only for the active taxpayers. For the non-active taxpayers, that is still there. So tax credits and deductible allowances, there are certain allowances available, like charitable donations and investments in shares of public and insurance premium. So one of my friend was interested that how can they reduce the tax liability of the employees So that friend need to understand that these are the provisions through which you need to see that how the tax can be reduced. If someone has paid charitable donations under section 61, that can also be, also reduce the tax liability. And then investment in shares and payment of insurance premium, subject to certain limitation, that it can also be, that also reduces the tax liability. And contribution to the approved pension fund, if you have made any investment in the approved pension fund, that is also adjustable, and you can reduce your tax liability. And deductible allowance for profit on debt paid in respect of housing loans, that is also the tax credit is also available, and you can reduce the tax liability of the employee. For education expenses, to say available for the person whose income is up to 1.5 million. So these are the things through which you can reduce the tax liability. And there are certain few further things I was just mentioning. Yes. So teachers rebate and adjustment by the employer, these are the things through which you can adjust. Because due to time limitation, you can read the section 13 and 14, and you can see that how the tax liability can be reduced. There are certain provisions as well. So mostly I have conveyed through this. Section 149, this is the most exercised section, because everyone who is paying the salary is the withholding tax agent. So then section 152, I have skipped for certain sections which are not practiced by the journal by the journal organization. There is section 148 on which the withholding tax agent is the custom authority, and then section 151, that is the profit on debt, that where withholding tax agent are the banks and financial institutions. Now we come to section 152, because most of you may be dealing while dealing for the payments to the non-residents. So this section deals to payments to the non-residents, and payment to the non-residents there are certain further separation in this payment to non-residents. And there is one type is payment to non-residents for royalty or fee for technical services, payment to non-residents for contract or subcontracts, and payment to non-resident person for insurance premium, payment to non-resident for advertising services. So there are certain different types of payments through the non-residents, and for each there are different tax rates, which I will explain. I have included the tax rate schedule as well. And you can find from section 150 from the first schedule as well. And then there is section 152-2A, that is the payments to permanent establishment of the non-resident persons in Pakistan. So that also deals for sale of goods, for rendering of services, or an execution of contracts. And here the withholding tax agents are, while taking the payment to non-residents, the withholding tax agents, as I said, that the withholding tax agents are prescribed by the government in each withholding tax provision. And in section 152, the withholding tax agents are the persons who are withholding tax agents for the purpose of section 153. And the withholding tax agents for the purpose of section 152 are, this is the most exercised section, the federal government, the company and association of person, foreign contractor, consortium, joint venture. And the only change which has been made through this budget is an individual and AOP having turnover of 100 million or more. And AOP and individual having annual turnover of 100 million and more, they are withholding tax agent. Here also 100 million in this. This is also 100 million. And one relaxation is that previously, prior to this Finance Act 2020, any registered person under the Sales Tax Act was withholding tax agent. But now any sales tax registered person having annual turnover of 100 million or more, they will be the withholding tax agent. So these are the rates under section for different types of withholding tax provisions. Royalty and fee for technical services, 15%, 7%, and 5%, and advertisement services, and different types of payments to non-residents that has different rates. So these are provided here in the rate schedule. And then there is a change in for the payments to permanent establishment of non-residents. So last year, there was under section 153 for the services, certain services reduced rate was introduced, but under section 152, it was not there. And the permanent establishment of non-residents, they suffered a lot because they said they are also working parallel to the local entities, because they have established their office here, and then why they are being discriminated. And this provision has been included 3% rate has also been included this year for the non-resident persons as well. So the payment to permanent establishment, that is just for the company, 4%, 4.5%. But especially for these services, the services of freight forwarding, air cargo, courier services, manpower outsourcing, hotel services, security guard services, software development, IT services, so tracking and engineering services, car rental, stock exchange limited, and certification and testing services, for these, the rate is 3%. And if for the services other than these, the rate is 8% in case of company and 10% other than company. So payments to permanent establishment of a non-resident person for payments against contracts. So that is again the similar 10% in case of sports person and 7% in other cases. Then the section 153, this is most exercised section for the withholding tax agents. And this section covers the payments to resident persons. The one section, section 152 covered the payments to non-resident persons, and section 153 covers the payments to the resident persons against sale of goods, providing or rendering of services, the execution of contract. And here the services are also defined, that include the services of accountants, architects, dentists, doctors, engineers. So here is a thin line between the services and the contracts. So normally by definition, we may consider that the services includes where some professional involvement is required. Only the professional services are to be considered as services. Other than those, though, the services will be considered as contract. And sale of goods, you all know that where the supply of goods is involved. So other than services and sale of goods, the whatever is, that is called the contract. So here the persons as withholding tax agent, those are the same as was in case of section 152. 100 million, 100 million, and I updated somewhere, but $100 million or more. So again, the same withholding tax agents. Same withholding tax agents who were the withholding tax agent for section 153. So in the second schedule, new clause 115 was inserted through the tax law second amendment ordinance 2019. Exception as withholding a tax under 153 for traders being individuals having turnover. So this has now become infructuous basically. This, although this clause has not been deleted, but mean for every person the turnover has been explained, turnover has been enhanced from 50 million to 100 million. That's why now the individual and AOP are the sales tax registered person having turnover of 100 million or more. They will become the withholding tax agent. Otherwise, they are not. And definitely the other persons, company, in any case, is withholding tax agent, non-profit organization, government department, they all are withholding tax agents. So these are the rates. The only change in these rates through the Finance Act 2020 is including toll manufacturing. So that has also been included in the supplies, and the rate has been remained the same, like 4% and 4.5%. But toll manufacturing has been included in this rate schedule. And in case of services, the engineering services with warehousing services and the asset management companies, data services provided by under the license of PTA and telecom infrastructure tower services, that these has been included in this rate schedule. Otherwise, this remained the same. And the case is the rate is 10%, 8% for companies, and other than companies is 10%. but 3% is for these services. Whosoever provides for the tax rate will be 3%. Here there is no discrimination on the status of the person to whom the payment is made. I mean, for all, whether it is individual or company or partnership, the rate will be 3%. But if the payments are made other than these services to companies, then rate is 8% and non-companies rate is 10%. And in case of contracts, that is 7.5%, and in case of payments to sports person, 10%, and in case of companies, 7%. So deductions under this section shall not be made. So there are certain exceptions which are provided in section 153, that is where sale of goods is made by an importer and tax under section 148 has been deducted and supplied, and this importer has supplied those goods in the same state. So there will be no deduction. In case of refund of any security, there will be no deduction. So payment of or purchase of an asset under lease and buyback. So for lease payments, there is no deduction. And then there are certain reduced rates provided under this in the second schedule. I hope PIFA will distribute this presentation to the participants so that they can have the references from this presentation. So provision of clause A of subsection 2 shall not applicable on the payment received petroleum agent. 153, the rate will be 1% for the distributor of cigarette. The export oriented sector, the rate is 1%. And for traders of yarn, the rate is 0.5%. The different, there are different provisions under part 4 of the second schedule, where certain part 3 and part 4, there are certain reduced rate are applicable. Those have been provided here. There are exemptions under section under SRO 586 of 1991, which is still intact basically through the saving provisions of the income tax ordinance. There are certain exceptions are provided from withholding of taxes under section 153, and those includes provincial and government and local authorities. Their withholding shall not be made while making the payment to the provincial and local authorities. Receipts of the growers and producers against supply of unprocessed agriculture produce, including fresh milk and fish, live chicken, birds, and eggs. Companies receiving payments against supply of electricity and gas. So from those, there will be no withholding. Payments to PSO, there will be no withholding. Hotels and restaurants receiving, this would be interesting for all of you. Hotels and restaurants receiving payments in cash for providing accommodation or food, both as in the case may be. So there will be no withholding. And who produce an exemption certificate from the commissioner, there will be withholding. So I would urge that also read SRO 586 of 1991. Normally it is provided in the tax law books. So adjustments, time of payment and adjustments. Through ledger accounts, tax is required to be deducted at the time the amount is actually paid or credited to the account of the recipient. So this need to be understand that in income tax withholding, the withholding is applicable at the time of payment or at the time of adjustment. When there is any adjustment in receivable and payable account, so then the withholding agent, whosoever becomes the withholding agent at that time, he has to adjust the amount and then pay it in the government treasury. And in case of foreign remittance, the payment is withholding tax, payment to non-resident or payment in the foreign currency for the payment to abroad. The tax is required to be deposited before making the payment. That is mean before making the payment. So amount paid as withholding agent, amount on behalf of the person is, there are certain liabilities or compliances for the withholding tax agents. Amount paid at the instructions of the personal withholding agent, gross amount settled or discharged by the person withholding agent other than netting off, and in case of remittance abroad to non-resident 7 days before the amount is intended to be remitted. So this is these are the requirements if you ought to make the payment, when the payment becomes due. Then there is another withholding section 155. Here the withholding tax agents are the company, federal government, provincial government, charitable institutions, and beauty parlors, individuals and AOPs. All are withholding tax agent. Basically, individuals and AOPs paying annual rent amounting to rupees 1.5 million or more, they also become the withholding tax agents. And this tax is adjustable for the person from whom the tax is being collected. And the rates are, the maximum rate is withholding tax rate is 15% for tax year 2020 onward. This year there was no change. And then there is section 150, 233, commission. So advertising commission, there is 10%. Life insurance, there is any person paying the commission, he has to also make the deduction of 10%, 8% in case of, covered above 12%. So there are certain compliances which a person or withholding tax agent has to make, that is deduction or collection of tax at source. Every person collecting or deducting tax is required to deposit in the government treasury within 7 days of ending of each week. But in case of foreign remittance, before 7 days of remittance the amount. But in case of local payments, within 7 days of ending of each week. I mean, during this payment, whichever payment you have made, you have to deposit the tax during the next week. So filing of quarterly. Now it has become quarterly. Although I changed, there are certain things which remain. So filing of quarterly withholding, this has changed now. Quarterly withholding tax statement for the income tax withheld and deposited. So now through Finance Act 2020, the filing requirement has been changed from biannual to quarterly. And filing of annual withholding statement for salaried person only, for salary only under Section 149. And then provision of tax deduction certificate along with copy of the payment tax challan and proof of payment income and paid. So we have covered the income tax now. We can have a short break you allow. And if anything administrator or somebody want to say, they can say, or we can have a 5 to 7 minutes question answer on the income tax. And then we will move forward to the sales tax as well. Mr. Edman. Sir, are you hearing? Can you hear me, sir? Anybody? Yes. We have concluded the income tax withholding and now we have to move forward towards the sales tax. I have shortened my presentation due to the time limitation because webinar was only for 2 hours. So I have explained the important withholding tax provisions, although I have covered many things. So the income tax part is over now. And after a question answer break about the income tax, we can now then move forward to the sales tax withholding.
Okay, sir.
Yes. So you can give the chance to the audience, if somebody wants to ask something, they can raise their hand or ask the question.
I have a question.
Yes.
My name is Kiran. I am currently working with the United Nations Development Program. My question was, does tax exemption for United Nations also apply on the employees working there? For example, I used to be a filer before joining United Nations, but now would be my first year after joining the UN. So I was concerned whether UN is exempt, and I guess some of its employees are also exempt from. I just wanted to confirm, should I file tax for the year or no?
Yes, you should file the return to become the filer, but there is exemption for the privileged person and United Nations exemption under section, I think 46 or 47. I just need to search. Just give me time. I can explain. Hold a few seconds, please. This is. I have explained previously that there is limitation of exemptions, but that also that means that whatever is not provided in the income tax ordinance, but this exemption is provided in the income tax ordinance, and that includes the exemptions to under the international agreements, and under section 42 there is the diplomatic and United Nations exemptions. So the salaried person who have special status under the privileged persons, they have exemptions under section 42.
Okay, so it means I have to file the tax.
You have to file, but your income will be exempt if it is paid under the United Nations exemption agreements and all that.
No, they actually make a sign an agreement in which they say that we are ourselves responsible for filing.
Yes, yes. No, filing is your responsibility, but only the tax exemption is provided
under
the income.
There is no deduction done by them. They don't deduct.
Even then, you can file the return to become the filer. You can declare your income as exempt.
I am already filer, but I'll continue filing the tax and will take benefit of the.
Yes, yes.
Okay.
Yes, walaikum salam.
So my name is Shahzeb. Basically, I have a question. I belong to a field of education and health sector, and I'm the head of finance there. We operate a medical college and a hospital. There are teachers who come there and educate. Now we are managed and run by a private limited company. The medical halls under that company. So I want to know whether the faculty, the teachers, are allowed the tax rebate or tax exemption, which is allowed to the teachers.
We need to read the clause where for the private entity, the teachers working with the private entities, they are not they will not be having any rebate. The clause 2, which is now visible on this slide as well, it says that the full-time teacher or researcher employed in a non-profit education or research institution. If your organization is a non-profit organization, then it applies. Any institution, and that should be duly recognized by the Higher Education Commission as well. And any board of education or university recognized by Higher Education Commission, including government training institutions. So for private institutions, the teachers working in the private educational institutions, they are not allowed to have this 25% rebate.
Right, sir. Thank you.
Assalamu alaikum, sir. My name is Samiullah Shah. I am from Islamabad. Currently, I am working in government college, medical college. Sir, I have a question regarding 236i, tuition fees tax.
Yes, there is a change this year. This year there is a change, and I have understood your question that this is also mean. That is also not being deleted from the from 236 from the 10th schedule. Yes, only the for the non-filers, non-active taxpayers, it will apply now. For the active, this will not apply.
Okay, sure, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Yes, for the non-active taxpayers. So whosoever that is also in case of if the fee is 200,000 or more. If the fee is less than 200,000, so then it will not apply to anybody. But if the fee is 200,000 or more, and the person is inactive, mean not appearing in the active taxpayers list, then you will withhold the tax, collect the tax. Otherwise, not. Yes.
Sir, I have a question in regard to withholding taxes. If a company or an individual is not registered as a filer, so we will be deducting the double of the rate of the applied taxes. Is this correct?
Not in all cases. There are certain exceptions. Not in all cases. These are the exceptions where that will not apply. These are the exceptions. Except these sections, then the tax rate will be double. If you are withholding under section 153, then definitely double tax. Whatever is rate under section 153, you will have to apply double rate, 100% increase. So if you are paying the rent amount, like under section 155, then you will not increase it by 100%. Right, sir?
Sir, thank you so much.
So you have to consult 10th schedule while making the payment and whether the rate would be double or not.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, sir.
Sir, I have a question.
Yes, please.
Sir, if a private limited company owns a pharmaceutical division and they do a retail business there, mm-hmm. and they purchase from a distributor of pharmaceutical product and they mm-hmm. sell it to general customer, okay, while making payment to the distributor, the mm-hmm. company has tax, right? Mm-hmm. It is 1% on the pharmaceutical product.
Yes,
right?
That's it. That is reduced rate. Yes, the second schedule provided in the second schedule, I think.
Right, and there are some other products like general supplies, like FMCG products, mm-hmm. Juices and mineral water bottles and all. Mm-hmm. So they are sold on. To the general consumer, but they are also purchased from a distributor. Mm-hmm. Now I want to know if the seller or if the vendor is not a registered distributor, he's just a shopkeeper, and the pharmacy purchased from that vendor. What amount of tax need to be deducted if it is not a?
Yes, no. You need to see the tax profile of the person who is supplying, because reduced rate is subject to certain things that will also only be for the distributor of the FMCG. So you have to see the tax profile of that person. If in the tax profile the distributor is not added, then you cannot do the same treatment, because that reduced deduction will be disallowed by the tax authority. So you have to ensure that really a distributor, he has a distribution of certain manufacturing companies, and that activity is also added in the tax profile of that company as well.
Okay, got it. Right, thank you.
Assalamu alaikum, Mian sir. Just one last question, brother. Just one last question. This is Faisal. Yes, this is Faisal from Sukchand Garden, sir. Sir, there is always a gray area. I'm working in the real estate sector. Or when we sell a property or we transfer a property, mm-hmm. 236C and 236K is applied. If it's a capital gain or purchase.
Yes,
there is always a gray area, and it has never been solved. That are we basically this SCG Private Limited? Are we a withholding agent or not? Are we allowed to collect the tax from the customer and then basically deposit it in the government treasury, or we are not allowed to do that.
No, you have you are an approved housing project, approved housing project.
Yes, sir. It's a private limited company. Yeah.
Private limited company, but I mean the NOC is granted to you.
Yes, NOC. We are the only project that has been granted the NOC.
Yes. So then you are responsible for registering the trust because the withholding agent is.
Sir, registering person, registering.
A transfer. I mean the withholding in 236K or 236C, the withholding agent is the person who is responsible for registering or transferring the property. So you are the person responsible for transfer of that property. So you.
But sir, basically the property is transferred with the registrar, na? वो तो पोटवारी जो होता है, he transfers basically. हम लोग तो just internal transfer करते हैं. We are not basically transferring. वो जिसको कहते हैं वो, हाँ जी.
There are two types of project. One is, I mean, you are just you have not got any NOC. You are you hold a land, I mean, private land, and you just make plots and then sell to the public and then get it registered from the registrar in Kachari or in Adalat. In that case, the registering or transferring authority is that registrar. But in case of a project housing as a developer. If you become a developer and you get NOC, then you get every authority to transfer that thing in the name of the one person or from one person to another person. So you have full authority to transfer the land. So in that case, you are the transferring and registering authority, in my opinion.
But in any case, the final registering authority is the registrar, the potwari. We are not the final authority, na? Because zameen ka wo jo ट्रांसफर होता है दैट इज फाइनली डन बाय द रजिस्ट्रार
सर मेरा ख्याल है कि जो मुझे जहां तक नॉलेज है अगर एक प्रोजेक्ट आप शुरू करते हैं तो उसमें आप गवर्नमेंट के पास सपोज आरडीए या सीडीए के पास अपनी जमीन जो है वो कुछ पोर्शन ट्रांसफर करते हैं एज ए सिक्योरिटी एंड देन यू आर अलाउड टू डू द डेवलपर बिजनेस यू डेवलप एंड आई मीन मेक द प्लॉट्स एंड सेल टू द जनरल पब्लिक एंड यू हैव द अथॉरिटी टू इशू द अलॉटमेंट लेटर्स एंड यू ट्रांसफर फ्रॉम वन पर्सन टू अनदर पर्सन एंड द पर्सन
एब्सोल्युटली करेक्ट
द पर्सन दे डोंट नीड टू गो टू द रजिस्ट्रार और सम अदर अथॉरिटी फॉर हैविंग देयर अमाउंट्स आई मीन दैट पीस ऑफ लैंड ट्रांसफर्ड इन देयर ओन नेम और रजिस्टर्ड इन देयर ओन नेम So you are the authority there. You make the allotment letters. You transfer. You give the right to that person that he can hold this property. He can construct this property. He can sell that property. So in my opinion, you are the final. In that case, you are the registering and transferring authority, and then you become the withholding tax agent.
Chale, thank you very much, sir. But there is still a gray area. If you ever have time, sir, if it is possible. So I would like to have a conversation with you because this problem has never been solved. We have consulted KPMG. We have consulted all the firms. It's a gray area. Nobody has given. Yeah.
No, your customer go to some.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. For the final land transfer, they have to go to the registrar.
If they do not.
वहाँ पे ज़मीन जाके उनके नाम के ऊपर पक्का वो उनके नाम के ऊपर होती है.
But I mean, वैसे housing project जो है अगर approved होता है तो then there is no need के वो उनके नाम पे further transfer हो वो already एक
But sir, the land actually purchases in the name of Sukchand Garden. Now we sell a piece of land. If that person wants that piece of land to be transferred in his name, he has to go to the registrar. Otherwise, the land is going to stay in SCG's name.
उसके अलावा आपको फिर NOC भी मिला है अप्रूवल भी मिली है एज ए डेवलपर आप
बट स्टिल द फाइनल रजिस्ट्रिंग अथॉरिटी इज द रजिस्ट्रार
ओके वी कैन डिस्कस बट इन माय ओपिनियन एट दैट टाइम यू आर विदहोल्डिंग टैक्स एजेंट
ठीक है थैंक यू सर
विदहोल्डिंग टैक्स एजेंट हैं वो एक अलग बात है फाइनल तो वो कोई कराए ना कराए जैसे बैरिया के बहुत सारे लोगों ने अभी करवाई नहीं है उन्होंने सारे के सारे जमीन जो बैरिया टाउन के नाम पे है और लोग जो हैं वो उसी के अलॉटमेंट लेटर पे सेल कर रहे हैं परचेज कर रहे हैं तो इस तरह से तो बहुत सारा ग्रे एरिया रह जाएगा जिसमें
जी सर वो तो बैरिया डजंट इवन बेसिकली हैव द एंटायर लैंड इन देयर नेम एज वेल ना बैरिया में तो वो फॉरेंसिक ऑडिट भी हुआ था उसमें भी उनका प्रॉब्लम था
नहीं दे हैड प्रॉब्लम्स इन दैट है कि नहीं है बहरहाल मेरा ख्याल है कि जब आपको प्रोजेक्ट की अप्रूवल होती है आप एज ए डेवलपर अप्रूव होता है आपका प्रोजेक्ट, यू आर ऑथराइज टू issue the allotment letter, you are authorized to transfer. अगर वो बंदा नहीं चाहता ना भी जाए वो, तो फिर भी उसी की प्रॉपर्टी होती है क्योंकि वो आपने प्रोजेक्ट अप्रूव ही उस हिसाब से करवाया है कि यू कैन सेल इट, एंड बाकी किसी को निकाल नहीं सकते हैं आप, वो फुल राइट्स हैं उस बंदे के पास, बेशक वो रजिस्ट्रार से रजिस्ट्री ना भी करवाए तो.
ठीक है सर, ठीक है, थैंक यू सो मच, थैंक यू सो मच, चलो वी शुड मूव फॉरवर्ड सर.
जी सर. So thank you very much. We had a question answer session of the income tax. Now we move forward to the sales tax. Sales tax, in the beginning I explained about the income tax. Now we need to firstly understand the sales tax mechanism as well. So sales tax, few concepts. So sales tax is an indirect tax charged, levied and paid on taxable supplies made by the registered persons for furtherance of any taxable activity, and taxable goods mean all goods other than those which have been exempted under the law. Sales tax is charged at the rate of 17% on the value of supply, except certain reduced rates or otherwise. So additional tax is also charged against supplies to unregistered person. This is just an overview, and tax rates on are applied on the sales at each stage. On the value addition, sales tax is also called a value added tax. So, I mean, this is also called a VAT. The persons who are, we have talked about the registered persons, because here registered persons, they only pay the tax. So the registered persons are section 14 of the Sales Tax Act. We are talking about the federal sales tax law now. Sales tax, section 14 of the Sales Tax Act. And rules 2006, the following persons are required to be registered: that any manufacturer who is not running a cottage industry. Cottage industry is, I mean, this is 3 million have total turnover more than supply is not exceed 3 million. Yes. Other than cottage industry, who is not running the cottage industry, every manufacturer is required to be registered as a registered person. The cottage industry means in manufacturing who does not have an industrial gas electricity connection, is located in residential area, does not have total labor force more than 10 workers, and annual turnover is less than 3 million. The small cottage industry, the women who are working in their homes and making something for supply, and the women who are the persons who are stitching the clothes or the garments, they come under this definition of cottage industry. Are making something else as in a low volume in residential houses, they are the cottage industry. Other than those, every manufacturer is required to be registered. Any retailer who is liable to pay sales tax, excluding tier two retailer. So there in retailers, there are two types of retailers, tier one and tier two. Tier one retailers are those who are in shopping malls, shopping plazas, and have electricity bill of more than 1.2 million. And their shop area is 1,000 square feet or more, they are the tier one retailer. And other than those are the tier two retailers. So tier one retailers are required to be registered. Any importer, any exporter, any wholesaler, any persons, jo bhi hai, other than who is required to be registered for the provincial, under the provincial sales tax law, they are required to be registered under the ICT law. So there is concept of input and output. So input tax is sales tax on purchases, and output tax is sales tax on sales. So this is normally the supply chain, the manufacturer, distributor, wholesaler, retailer, and then final consumer. And if we come on this way, manufacturer, importer, commercial importer, wholesaler, and then retailer, and then consumer. So this is the supply chain and how the tax works. A normal mechanism, VAT mode fix. Then there is a Yes, this. How it works? I mean, how the sales tax mechanism works? There is a normal mechanism which is called the VAT mode. How it works? Like party A sells to party B the goods of amounting to rupees 100, and then it will charge 17% sales tax, and the amount will become 117. So then the party B sells to the goods, those goods to party C, and sales tax is charged at the rate of 17%, 22, and then total value of supply will become 152 for the final consumer. Suppose party C is a final consumer, and B is a trader and A is a manufacturer. We just suppose. So how the sales tax liability of B trader is calculated? That is, the output tax is on his sales, this one, and the input tax on his purchases from the manufacturer, and the sales tax payable by the party B will be the remaining amount on the value addition. This is called the normal VAT mode. So then there is a fixed tax regime as well, third schedule items in Pakistan. Third schedule items mean where the tax is paid on the retail price based, and these are provided in the third schedule. Basically, the manufacturer or the importer pays the tax on the final price of the goods. I mean, if the retail price is suppose 150, but it is being sold to the distributor as 120, but the manufacturer will pay the tax on 150. So I mean, there will be the tax on behalf of the further chain is being paid by the manufacturer. So these are the goods which are provided here, on which the sales tax is being made, being paid on retail price, and these are called the third schedule items. And there is zero rating regime. So there are certain goods, especially the exports, those are zero rated. And there are certain goods who are exempt from tax. Excuse me. Excuse me, just a small break. Someone is calling in Zahid Farooq, sir. Yes, sir. Sorry, I'm back. Is there anybody listening?
Yes.
Yes.
Sir, we all are here.
Okay. Are you? Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. You are.
Okay. You okay. Are, so, sales tax mechanism. We were just discussing that how that sales tax mechanism works. I mean, it is a normal regime, fixed tax regime, zero regime, zero rating regime, and exemptions. There are certain exemptions, and there are certain reduced rates which are provided in the 8th schedule. Just I'm giving an overview that how, what is the mechanism of sales tax. And then value addition tax on imports, 12th schedule, and withholding regime, 11th schedule. So this is, how the sales tax mechanism is working. So we have just explained that how it is work, it works. So zero rating mean the goods exported are the goods specified in the fifth schedule. These are zero rating, and normally the exports of goods and supplies to the exporter sectors are charged to sales tax at the 0%. And there are certain exemptions available under the sales tax law. That is the under the sixth schedule, those exemptions, and it has three tables. Table one is exemption on imports and supplies, exemption on local supplies, table two, and there are the table 3, there is table 3 which contains the items on which the conditional exemptions is provided. 8th schedule, those are subject to reduced rate, and then there is a fixed tax on the 9th and 10th schedule, and then value addition under the on the imports under the 12th schedule. So sales tax on, there is on sales tax on services as well. Levy of sales tax in the is in the domain of provinces. The provinces has got autonomy and collecting their sales tax at their own. Islamabad Capital Territory is collecting sales tax under the federal sales tax law, that is Sales Tax Act 1990. So, and there is a federal excise which is being collected under the Sales Tax Act in VAT mode, like edible oil, vegetable ghee, steel billets, ingots, and plates, that is also under the sales tax regime. And compliances for the sales tax registers persons are, who are liable to be registered, they are required to be registered, and they have to charge the sales tax and collect the sales tax from the customer, and then issue the invoices, maintain records, and to act with withholding agent wherever required, and deposit the sales tax and file the sales tax return on monthly basis. And there is joint and several liability because it works in a chain from one person to another person. And if someone makes some default or fraud, the other person is also responsible for that. Sales tax withholding under the federal law, because our today's topic is withholding, like income tax, there is withholding regime in the sales tax, and I think it is said that nowhere in the other world sales withholding sales tax withholding regime is working, only in Pakistan. So the amount of sales tax, as you all know, is collected from the final consumers by the registered persons, and normally sales tax collected is deposited by the registered person in the government treasury, because he is collecting the tax from the final purchaser. To control the tax evasions, the withholding of sales tax has been made mandatory. Previously it was made mandatory for the public sector and corporate sector. Initially it was made mandatory for the public sector, and then it was extended to the corporate sector as well. And under the withholding tax regime, certain portion of sales tax is withheld by the withholding tax agent and deposited in the government treasury on behalf of the supplier, because here the purchaser withholds some tax from the supplier and deposits in the government treasury, whether through the withholding statement or through his own tax return. So under the sales tax law, this is the schedule of the withholding tax. So this is very simple schedule has been prepared in this presentation as well. So who is with the withholding agent, and what type of supplier category, and what amount, rate and amount is provided here. So in case of federal government is the purchaser, and are the companies as defined in the Companies Ordinance, they are the purchaser. So they become the withholding tax agent. And the supplier category is if the suppliers are on the active taxpayer's role. So active taxpayer list is maintained for the income tax and sales tax purpose separately. So here you have to see the active taxpayer list under the Sales Tax Act. So if the person is in the active taxpayer list, that is maintained, you can check on the website as well while making the payment to any supplier. So if he is active, then 1/5 of the sales tax shown on the invoice, that is the withholding amount. And if the person an active taxpayer registered as a wholesaler, dealer, or distributor, then there is different rate for the wholesaler, dealer, or distributor, that is 1/10 of the sales tax as shown on the invoice. And if the person is not on the active taxpayer, then the whole amount of the sales tax involved are as the applicable to the supplies on the basis of the gross value of the supplies. Here sometimes the question arises whether the gross amount means the total invoice, that will include the inclusive of tax or exclusive of tax. The law says the exclusive of tax, you have to apply the tax. But there is exception that if agreed between the supplier, then you can treat that amount inclusive of sales tax. Then there is companies. For companies as defined in the income tax ordinance, persons other than active taxpayers, they will deduct 5% of the gross value of supplies. So if government, if the purchaser is the government, the whole amount is deducted from the supplier. And if the purchaser is the company, private company, then 5% of the gross value of supplies. And registered person as a recipient of advertisement services, the whole amount of sales tax applicable. And registered persons purchasing cane molasses, that is in case of sugar or sugar cane, whole amount of sales tax as applicable. So this is the withholding sales tax under the 10th and under the 10th schedule of the Sales Tax Act. So there are certain exceptions. Certain exceptions means where the sales tax withholding under the federal law will not apply. That includes exception from the sales tax includes electricity, energy, mean payments to the electric companies, natural gas, petroleum products as supplied to petroleum agencies, vegetable ghee and cooking oil against that the withholding will not apply. Telecommunication services, the withholding will not apply. Goods specified in the third schedule, as I said, on that the withholding tax shall not apply. Goods supplied by the importers who had paid value addition tax on such goods, the income tax is also exempt for the importers. The sales tax withholding is also exempt on that. And supplies made by an active taxpayer as defined in the Sales Tax Act to another registered person. So here, if the supplies are made by an active taxpayer to another registered person who is required to be registered or is registered person, then there will be no withholding. And this last clause has been added through Finance Act 2020 that supply of sand, stone, gravel, crush and clay to low-cost housing scheme sponsored or approved by Naya Pakistan Housing Authority, in this case withholding will not apply as well. And then withholding tax under the provincial sales tax laws, that is also a simple table. In Punjab, there is a different rule that the persons, these are the withholding tax agents, and the persons providing services registered under the Punjab sales tax, under the person providing advertisement, except the person providing advertisement and companies being active taxpayer, at least whole amount of sales tax. Here, if a company is a service provider, then there is no withholding. But other than company, there is 100% withholding from the sales tax. And the persons providing taxable services and not registered under the Punjab Sales Tax Act, whole amount of sales tax is being charged. Even if the company is providing the services but is not registered, then whole amount of sales tax will be withheld by the withholding agent. But if the service provider is a company, then there will be no withholding. Other than companies, there will be whole amount will be withheld by the withholding agent. So there are also exceptions relating to telecommunication, banking, courier, insurance. It shall not apply on the services except advertisement are provided in the companies being active taxpayer insurance services provided. For the sales tax withholding under the SINH sales tax, that is also similar to the federal, 1/5 of the sales tax on services charged, and who are not registered under the SINH Sales Tax Act, whole amount of sales tax, and for recipient of services, whole amount. For recipient of services, of advertisement services, whole amount is withheld. There is also exception under the SINH Sales Tax withholding, which is telecommunication, banking, financial institution, port, airport, terminal, and airport ground. This is under the Baloch Khyber Pakhtunkhwa withholding tax rules, The withholding agent, same 1/5 and whole amount, 1/5 in case of registered and whole amount in case of unregistered person, and for recipient of advertisement services, whole amount if the recipient of services is also registered under the KPK law. Balochistan sales tax law, under the Balochistan sales tax special procedure withholding rules, the same procedure. Only in Punjab there is a difference. Otherwise, mean the same procedure is adopted, the same tables. This is summarized. Basically, if registered 1/5 in ICT, there is a different, and in Punjab, different. But other than those, means similar, and there is exception. This is summarized of the previous table. And compliances for the withholding tax agents are deduction of tax, deposit of sales tax collected on a monthly basis, and deposit of sales tax collected on a monthly basis along with sales tax withholding statement. In case withholding agent is not registered, here one thing which is not being practiced, that sales tax withholding is not on payment based, it is on invoice based. The month in which you receive the invoice, the withholding is applicable on that month, even if you pay or not. If you pay later, but if you have received the invoice during this month, the withholding tax, the applicable withholding tax will have to be deposited during this month. So this is one thing which is not being practiced, but in the law, in the rules, it is so. So with this, I end my presentation, and if there is any question answer, we can. I tried my best to conclude my presentation within the time limit. So now we can have the question answer about the sales tax withholding, and then we may wind up the session with the by the special guest. So, Mr. Sir, Adman. Yes, please.
Sir, I have a question regarding to sales tax. I'm working in Keep Trucking. It's operating in IT industry, and then it provides sales IT enablement services. But the thing is that the operations are in US, and then the sales are being done in US. Basically, we are operating an office over here, currently having all the employees over here. So it's basically a cost center. So we don't have any output sales over here. So the input sales that we are incurring, can we claim those input tax that, or it would be treated as loss when it comes to accounting purposes?
It will be treated as cost, not loss. Because when your output is exempt, are not taxable. Basically, the taxes, the output tax, output is not taxable, then it becomes as your cost. So export of IT services is non-taxable. Basically, if it would have been zero rated, then you could have claimed that tax. But it is export of IT or IT enabled services in are not taxable. So that's why it is the whatever input you have, that will become your cost, not loss.
Sir, asal mein ye hai ki हमारी जो कंपनी है वो तो इधर कोई सेल्स वगैरह कर नहीं रही बेसिकली वो तो अमेरिका में
जी नो बट वो बेसिकली आपकी सेल्स नहीं कर रही तो आपकी आउटपुट है ही नहीं ना जस्ट कॉस्ट
इन जी जी आप जी जी
आप इवन यहां से इनवॉइस भी नहीं रेज करते
मतलब बेसिकली हम पेरेंट जो हमारी पेरेंट कंपनी उनको हम इनवॉइस कर लेते हैं मतलब जो हमारी सैलरीज वगैरह बनती हैं और जो कॉस्ट जो
आप कॉस्ट टू कॉस्ट पे वो कर लेते हैं बट एनी
एग्जैक्टली
ये भी आप ऐसे कर नहीं सकते आर्म्स लेंथ ट्रांजैक्शन होनी चाहिए अभी तो वो वहां पे डायरेक्टरेट भी है ट्रांसफर प्राइसिंग का वो आपको उसमें कर सकते हैं बेसिकली ये एक सेपरेट एंटिटी है आपकी इधर लोकल एंटिटी सेपरेट है या फॉरेन एंटिटी ही की ब्रांच है
सर उसको सब्सिडियरी कंसीडर करते हैं मतलब हमारी जो कंपनी वो कीप ट्रकिंग है मतलब जो अमेरिका में चल रही है इधर जो हम रजिस्टर्ड है एबीएस लैब्स एज अ सब्सिडियरी ऑफ कीप ट्रकिंग
लेकिन आपको बेसिकली आर्म्स लेंथ ट्रांजैक्शन करके उसमें प्रॉफिटेबिलिटी भी शो करनी चाहिए आप बिल्कुल उसको एक्सपेंसेस के अगर करीब करेंगे तो जो ट्रांसफर प्राइसिंग है और आर्म्स लेंथ ट्रांजैक्शन का जो रूल है वो भी वायलेट होता है.
तो वो फिर 5% कमीशन हम वो रखते हैं, वो मैनेजमेंट फीस वगैरह उसका 5% लगा के वो पे चार्ज करते हैं.
ठीक है, दैट इज ओके, बट मीन वो आपकी कॉस्ट ही बन जाए, बाकी जो यहाँ पे इनपुट टैक्स है वो आपकी कॉस्ट है.
सर मतलब बेसिकली ये कि जो भी अब इनपुट टैक्स जो हम उसकी अकाउंटिंग ट्रीटमेंट करते हैं, मतलब जो भी वेंडर्स होते हैं उनकी ना ये इनपुट टैक्स जो सेल्स टैक्स वगैरह होते हैं उसको हम सेपरेट हेड में ले लेते हैं एज इनपुट टैक्स
ना लिया करें, वो इनपुट टैक्स नहीं है आपकी, वो कॉस्ट है.
तो मतलब जो हम वेंडर्स को पेमेंट करते हैं तो बेसिकली एज अ होल हम पेमेंट, अभी हम इवन हम सेल्स टैक्स में भी रजिस्टर्ड है.
ठीक है, वो तो आपको तो हो सकता है कोई लोकल सर्विसेज भी आपने प्रोवाइड करनी हो, लोकली तो आपको सेल्स टैक्स चार्ज करना पड़ेगा.
आई थिंक जो टू शॉर्टेज ऑफ टाइम मीन सर वी कैन आस्क यू सेपरेटली वन मोर क्वेश्चन ऑन सेल टैक्स प्लीज.
हां जी चलिए ठीक है, थैंक यू फॉर वाचिंग.
मेरा इनकम टैक्स रिफंड के ऊपर एक क्वेश्चन है, 236 और 236W जो है उसकी कोई टाइम लिमिट है कि कब तक के जो है ना, और उसका प्रोसीजर क्या है रिफंड का?
सेक्शन 170 है इनकम टैक्स ऑर्डिनेंस में, उसमें आप एप्लीकेशन दे सकते हैं विद इन 3 years जिस साल आपने टैक्स रिटर्न फाइल की हो या असेसमेंट ऑर्डर हो, और उसके बाद अगर 2 महीने में वो आपको रिफंड नहीं मिलता तो आप मीन उसके अगेंस्ट नेक्स्ट लेवल पे जा सकते हैं. तो ये बेसिकली सेक्शन 170 अगर आप देखेंगे तो यू विल हैव ऑल द डिटेल्स.
नेक्स्ट लेवल क्या होगा उसका क्लेम का?
आप सर उसमें मीन आप या तो वो अगर उन्होंने नहीं किया तो आप नेक्स्ट लेवल में उसकी कंप्लेंट FTO में कर सकते हैं, फेडरल टैक्स एम्बर्समेंट में.
We will share it. Yeah, thank you so much.
Okay, so thank you very much, Mia Ramzan Saab, Aga Saab, Zahid Farooq Saab, and other distinguished guests. So, Sir Mia Ramzan Saab, it was very comprehensive and very detailed session, and with a very good and positive feedback from Facebook and social media, from chat room as well. So, thank you very much. So, I would like to request Sir Zahid Farooq Saab to please conclude the session.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Salamu salli ala Muhammadin Nabil Ummi wa ala alihi wa salim taslima. Thank you very much, Mr. Bashpur, for inviting me for our concluding remarks on today's webinar. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
First of all, I'm grateful to learned speaker Mia Muhammad Ramzan Saab for accepting our request to deliver lecture on a very important topic of withholding taxes. I'm really impressed by his style, his techniques, and in-depth knowledge of this subject. He explained each and every aspect briefly in a very interesting way. As a token of appreciation, I request to join hand for a big clap for him.
Thank you, sir.
Getting benefit of this forum, I think I am bound to give some useful information regarding withholding taxes. Inshallah, it will not take more than 5 minutes.
Yes.
Can you see my presentation?
Not at the moment, sir. Yes, now. Yes, it is okay now, sir.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. I will start with my presentation. Yes. There are some useful information regarding withholding taxes. First of all, there are some basic exemption while deducting any withholding tax from any person, like under Section 149, before deducting taxes, you should know that what is the basic exemption of salaries. These are about 600,000 rupees. If someone has salary for a year of about 600,000 rupees, then you should not deduct any tax on this salary. Similarly, we have many times we have questions from our clients also that what are basic exemption of on goods and services. On goods, basic exemption is 75,000 per person per year. This means if you are making any payment to any person for a full year below 75,000, then you should not deduct any tax on that amount. Similar case is for services. It is 30,000 per person per year. If you are paying any amount to any person for services, then if this amount is less than 30,000 or equal to 30,000, you should not deduct any tax on it. Similar case is for rent under Section 155. 200,000 per person is a basic limit. Beyond that amount, you should deduct any tax. In case of company, if you are making payment of rent to any company, then there is no basic exemption. You have to deduct tax on full amount of that. Similarly, on cash withdrawal is 50,000 per day, and other banking transaction, it is 25,000 per day. And in this Finance Act, it was introduced that on transfer of motor vehicle, there is basic exemption that transfer of 850cc motor vehicle, there will be no tax collected by the transferring authorities. And similar cases are for electricity bill on commercial and industrial bill, 400, on domestic bill, 75,000, and on telephone, 1,000. And on education fee per annum, it is 200,000. If someone is paying 200,000 for the year, then no tax will be deducted from that person. Second is payment of tax collected or deducted. Many times, again, our client asks question that when and how to pay tax collected or deducted. There are two conditions of deduction and deposit of taxes. One is under Rule 43A, where tax has been collected or deducted by federal government or provincial government on the day tax was collected or deducted. On the same day, they are bound to deposit the tax collected or deducted. But in case of other than federal government or provincial government, all other persons are required to deposit tax in State Bank of Pakistan or National Bank of Pakistan within 7 days from the end of each week ending on Sunday. After the end of the week in which tax was deducted or collected, they are required to deposit that tax within 7 days. Here another requirement. Last year it was biannually with holding filing of withholding statement. Now under this Finance Act 2020, this requirement has been changed. You have to file withholding taxes on quarterly basis from July to September, on 20th October, and October to December, and similarly, these are the things. What will happen if withholding statement not filed on due date? This is a penalty under Section 182 if you do not file withholding income tax statement within due date. Such person shall pay a penalty of 5,000 if the person had already paid tax collected or withheld by him within due date for the payment and statement is filed within 90 days from the due date of filing statement. Agar 90 days ke andar file kar diya, then you are liable to pay penalty of 5,000. But if in all other cases, penalty of 2,500 for each day of default from the due date, subject to minimum penalty of 10,000, which is a very big amount, you should take care of filing withholding statement within due date. Consequences of not withholding income tax. Here there are many problem you will have to face if you do not deduct tax or deposit it timely. All expenses from which person was required to deduct or collect tax will be disallowed under Section 21C. And you know, income tax is charged on net income basis after deducting all expenses related with the business. But if you do not deduct taxes, withholding taxes while making payment, these expenses will not be allowed, which will be disallowed in other words. The person who failed to deduct withholding taxes will be required to pay withholding taxes from his own pocket under Section 161(1)(b). If someone is failed to deduct or withhold income tax from payment, they may be required to pay that withholding tax from his own pocket. And third is, person will be required to pay falling default surcharge and penalties under Section 161 and 182. 161, person shall be liable to pay default surcharge at the rate of 12% per annum from the date he failed to collect or deduct tax to the date tax was actually paid. And under Section 182, such person shall be liable to pay a penalty of 40,000 rupees or 10% of the amount of tax, whichever is higher. What are remedies available? If a person is failed to deduct or collect withholding tax, income tax, he can give following argument. Under Section 161(1)(b), where at the time of recovery of tax under subsection 1, it is established that tax was to be deducted from the payment made to a person or collected from a person has meanwhile been paid by that person, no recovery shall be made from the person who had failed to collect or deduct tax, but the said person shall be liable to default surcharge at the rate of 12% as discussed above. This means that if payee has paid tax, then the person making payment will not be responsible to pay original tax. That should be deducted or collected. However, he must have to pay default surcharge at the rate of 12% as discussed. Another remedy is that the Section 158 has specially laid down that tax deduction shall be made at the time amount is actually paid. This means you are not required to deduct or pay tax on transaction which has incurred on accrual basis. If we have incurred some expenses on accrual basis, then we have not to deduct or deposit tax on that amount. This is supported by Income Tax Case Law 2009 PTD 361 decided by Appellate Tribunal in NLW Lahore. It was said that tax deduction is to be made only when amount is actually paid. This means, again, whenever you make any payment, then you are required to pay to deduct or collect taxes. But if you are not making any payment, any cash payment, then you are not required to deduct any tax. It means that under Section 21C, the expenses which were disallowed on not deducting taxes, these were on accrual basis, these will be allowed. Another remedy is that according to Proviso 221C, subsequent recovery of any amount of tax under Section 161, 162 shall be considered tax paid. This means that if in case withholding tax was actually required to be deducted and paid, has been paid by the person making payment or by the person receive payment, then disallowance of expenses shall not be made. Means expenses from which withholding tax was not deducted and paid at the time of making payment of expenses will be allowed in this case. Another relief is that according to Section 21C, whole amount of expenses will be disallowed if required income tax was not deducted. However, to this general rule, there is an exception which is as under according to proviso 221c, this allows in respect of purchases of raw material and finished good under this clause shall not exceed 20% of purchase of material and finished good. We can claim that whole amount should not be disallowed. Instead, only 20% of these expenses should be disallowed according to this proviso. Another relief which was provided by Income Tax Appellate Tribunal, this is we can claim if fail to deduct tax or collect withholding tax is given by Appellate Tribunal, that traveling expenses, conveyance expenses and communication and selling expenses, there is no requirement of withholding taxes. As Appellate Tribunal said, we feel that there is a considerable force in argument of learned AR that the expenses claimed under the head traveling, conveyance, communication and selling could not be disallowed with reference to the proviso of section 21C of Income Tax Ordinance. This is, you can also put an argument that this should not be disallowed. What is my advice? My advice is on withholding tax is that if your customer is not willing to allow to withhold income tax, then you should make payment from your own pocket on timely basis. This is, will result in falling, saving of income tax. Normally, companies are required to pay income tax at the rate of 29% of net income. If an expense is not allowed, then company has to pay on that amount income tax at the rate of 29%, which should be about 4 to 4.5% in case of payment for goods and services. Avoidance of default surcharge, you can avoid it by making payment from your own pocket. Another thing, you can avoid penalties also. And last thing is that you can avoid legal advisor fee. You can save it, which will otherwise be payable in case of litigation with tax authorities. With these words, thank you very much. Over to you, Rishko, sir.
Very good. Zabardast, sir. I mean, the point.
I tried.
Cover. You have, included those very important points in the presentation. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
So these were very important things which you highlighted, basically.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
So now we are over, sir. Session
with
is over.
Words, yes, sir. So with these words, thank you very much from me for all participants and special thanks to Mia Saab. Thank you very much, sir. Take care. Allah Hafiz.
Allah Hafiz. Grateful, sir. Thank you so much. Allah Hafiz.